Hello and welcome to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray. And before we get rolling today, I just want to kind of do a little promo for the fundraiser. We do one charity fundraiser a year for my husband's scholarship. And you might remember that Jim passed away about 5 years ago, a little over 5 years. And he was an avid golfer and musician and just a very eclectic kind of guy, lots of different interests. So we started an golf outing and scholarship luncheon in his memory to raise money for scholarships. So far, we have awarded six. We've awarded our sixth scholarship this year. Our very first scholarship winners graduated from Bowling Green State University in May, and both of them have jobs as band directors at local high school. So we're very excited about that. So we want to keep this going in his honor, and it will be Saturday, August 24th. It's always the last Saturday of August, and it will be at 8 a.m. at Maumee Bay State Park at the golf course there. And then the scholarship luncheon will be at 12:30 at the Shelter House at the Maumee Bay Golf Course. Now, if you're not a golfer, don't worry. Just come to the scholarship luncheon. That's why we kind of promo that separately. They both occur at the same time, though. And if you're interested, just go to jmurray, M-U-R-R-A-Y, scholarship.org, and you'll find all the information there on this fundraiser. So we appreciate your generosity over the years. We've been able to continue to award scholarships and award renewals of scholarships. So our first graduates received renewals every year of the scholarship. So hopefully put that on your calendar, save the date, the 24th, go to the website, and let's see if we can continue to make this outing grow. Okay, so enough of that. Put it on your calendar. That's next month. This is July, and July is certainly, we talk about Independence Day, freedom, and there's been a lot of, I was listening to a lawyer talk about the decline of free speech in our country. But I was very taken by an article that I read in the Catholic Thing called Free Exercise of Religion and Catholic Responsibility. And the author, I looked him up online, and he was gracious enough to say yes to this, is Thomas Farr. He was the first director of the State Department's Office of International Religious Freedom. And in between that and the co-founding of Religious Freedom Institute, he also taught at Georgetown courses. I think he said the foreign academic area, and then it was international religious freedom that you taught courses
in? Yes, it was on religious freedom in general, but also with an emphasis on U.S. international religious freedom policy and national security, which was my background before I got into this issue. So
that's great. And then you became president of the Religious Freedom Institute. Now you're president emeritus, and he's currently writing a book on the American gift of religious freedom, which is wonderful because in this day and age, I think there are some people that don't see it as a gift. So I'm glad you're doing that. Welcome, Tom. Thanks so much for doing this today.
Thank you, Pat. It's so wonderful to be with you and on Annunciation Radio, which has done so much to continue the work of Al Cresta.
We all
miss him.
What a great guy. I was so excited. I got to know him years ago when I was on the board for Annunciation Radio. And then in January, February, and April, they had asked me to come in and sub for his show. And so I got to meet him again and talk with him. And he, you could tell he was tired, and he said he was tired, but I knew they couldn't quite figure out yet what was going on. And so by the time they found out, he certainly didn't have long with us after that, but certainly left a great legacy, not only in radio, but in family. I mean, just a beautiful family. So, and he goes before us to prepare a way for us. So that's a good
indeed
thing.
And I would just add, Pat, that probably 10 years ago, when I was at Georgetown, we had an event in Rome. It was a big 3-day event, involved the Pope and a number of things. He had just been elected Pope, and Al came to Rome and interviewed a number of the participants in this. So he was interested in the issue of religious freedom in all of its dimensions, and I will always be grateful for that.
Yeah, yeah, just an amazing man. So what, you know, because the you were kind of a co-founder of this Religious Freedom Institute, and you were the first director of the State Department's Office of International Religious Freedom. So I take it, did the State Department not have this office until you were appointed to it?
Well, the answer is yes, but it wasn't my appointment that started it. It was an act of Congress in 1998 called the International Religious Freedom Act, which at the time was, you'll probably recall that Bill Clinton was president
yes
most of the 1990s, and he signed a number of laws that were very, very encouraging to religious freedom supporters, including the Religious Freedom Restoration Act,
right,
the Defense of Marriage Act, and things like this. So at the time, it created an office in the State Department. I had been a diplomat for a number of years and had just converted to Catholicism
oh
with my family. And all of this came together, and so I became the first director of this office. But that was the professional director who worked directly under a political appointee who was the ambassador for religious freedom, ambassador at large.
Oh.
So I worked under the first two ambassadors, then left for Georgetown to teach on this and the domestic aspects of the issue, and then formed the Religious Freedom Institute in 2016.
Oh, okay. So that's coming up on, it's been about 8 years then. So what,
sure,
what brought about the Religious Freedom Institute? What kind of made you pursue that?
Well, it was very much like the reason that I left the State Department and went to Georgetown to teach about this. I came to the conclusion, as a Catholic and as a professional, meaning foreign policy as well as domestic policy, that this was very, very important, but that it was in trouble, and that we weren't taking as much care in protecting religious freedom as a culture.
Mm-hmm.
Most people, when they think of religious freedom, think of the Supreme Court, and justifiably so. But the problem that I see we're having is with the culture. So the Religious
yes
Freedom Institute focuses primarily on education. It doesn't argue in the courts, although we write amicus briefs for the great institutions that do argue in the court, like the Beckett Fund or
right
the Alliance Defending Freedom. But we believe that there is a cultural problem and a political problem in the way that religious freedom is being treated today. So that's why I, along with three other gentlemen, decided to create the Religious Freedom Institute. Its precursor was actually at Georgetown, but we wanted to become a separate and independent nonprofit, which we did in 2016.
Okay.
And again, what we do is promote this in education. We educate from K through emeritus, and by the way, that's just a word for old.
But it sounds so nice.
It does. It sounds very elegant.
It does.
But it means that I turned the presidency of the organization over to a wonderful guy named David Trimble, who is the president today, and I try to help him.
Mm-hmm.
But this was my fourth career, and it was time for me to pay more attention to my wife of 54 years and my three daughters and 11 grandchildren and one great-grandchild, all of whom, most of whom live in this area of Virginia where I live.
Yeah,
so anyway, RFI, as we call it, the Religious Freedom Institute, was just designed to educate everyone from, as I say, K through emeritus, about the precious gift that the American founders gave us in the First Amendment and what they intended to do with it. And it's in trouble today, and we want to defend it.
Yeah. And I want to kind of maybe get to the heart. I mean, I love this article, and I wrote all over it with notes and questions and things. But as you talk about this Religious Freedom Institute, and you talk about like 1999, you know, where all these, you know, the Freedom Restoration Act, things like that were coming through. I mean, we've made this shift in like 20 years. What, in your estimation, as you've worked with this, has speared this or spearheaded this to move so quickly that it's like in a flash we're in a different place?
It really is scary, isn't it, when you think about particularly... There are a number of issues here that have been with us a long time, such as abortion and so forth. But the gender identity issues that we're facing today seem like they just came up yesterday.
Yeah.
I mean, I wasn't, and I doubt if many of your listeners were thinking too much about these issues and their effect on particularly on women, but on our culture and our education system and our public education in particular. And so, I think the answer, the honest answer to that very good question, is that a lot of this is very, very old. It is simply human beings deciding that, you know, either God doesn't exist, or if he does, he's not involved in his creation, which, of course, is the opposite of the Catholic understanding. But it's an understanding. It's been out there for many, many centuries. It's not new. It's a conclusion that we're all, it's idolatry is what it is.
Yeah.
We're all autonomous. But these aspects of it have captured our culture, our major institutions, and, you know, I don't intend to be politically partisan here, but much of this is accepted by all members of the Democratic Party and increasing numbers of Republicans. So I don't think the solution to the problem lies in politics. It lies in just plain Americans. And in particular, I would argue, Catholics, I call them Catholics of the Catechism, Catholics who actually believe want to live as the Church has not always been consistent in living, but has encouraged us since the very beginning to live, both in private and in public.
Yeah. Do you think, Tom, that when we look at, because you lay this out so nicely in your article, when you talk about the kind of these unalienable rights and understanding who we are, the nature of the human person, and but also that we are fallen creatures. And so it's almost like, you know, the Declaration of Independence, you know, we hear, you know, the pursuit of happiness. And now, and I would think it is the fallen nature that is kind of spearheading this. But now it appears that we don't even understand what happiness is for a human being. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think it does. I mean, the one thing I think it's probably reasonable to say is that every human being of whatever opinion or habit of virtue or rejection of God or acceptance of God wants to be happy.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's sort of an instinct that appears to be with us. The question is, how do you get there? And of course, my own approach to this is, I think, the approach of the Catholic Church, and that is that suffering is going to come to each of us. We shouldn't seek it, but we are to deal with it as it comes. Our Lord told us this. So you cannot be happy if you think you're not going to suffer in this life.
Yeah.
in so many different ways, sometimes at the hands of other men and women, sometimes because of just things that happen and natural disasters, that kind of thing. So it's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
What does happiness mean? How do you achieve it? The answer, it seems to me, has always been the Catholic answer or the Christian answer, namely to love God and love your neighbor because you love God.
Right.
Now, that's easy to say, but filling all of that in is, as we all know, not easy,
mm-hmm.
because we're fallen, as you said. I mean, we're tempted by our nature, and struggling against that is part of what it means to be happy, struggling successfully.
Right.
But to abandon it and just say, and that's what has happened today.
Mm-hmm.
So many people believe that I'm going to be happy if I can just carve out my own meaning of what that means, if I can do what I want to do, as long as I don't harm somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
That harm principle is insidious, by the way.
It
obviously
is.
We don't want to harm somebody else, but if that's the only limit on what we can do, then so much for virtue, so much for being good for the sake of being good.
Right.
And that is a very, very serious problem in our culture. As I say in the piece, it's captured most of our major institutions, and unfortunately, although they wouldn't accept this description of it, a major political party and the current administration defines and wants to redefine what it means to be a human being.
Yeah.
So again, that's an old problem, but we are seeing new versions of this old problem, and I think Catholics are the ones that really have the way to fight this. Unfortunately, we don't all understand the stakes here.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there's lots to be done.
Well, and I think, too, we are in a society that it changes meanings of words. And so, like, even happiness, even love, are all about me and what I
right.
want. And it's never, you know, the kind of the classical understanding of happiness and human flourishing and love is, you know, the good of the other. Those kinds of things just seem to be so foreign. And even some of the things you mentioned in your article, you know, the idea of, you know, accumulating wealth and power, satisfying our desires, you know, like all of that will take us to happiness. And yet, we see time and time again, it doesn't. Yet
yeah.
we keep doing it.
We keep doing it, and it ends for many people in misery. And I think just as most of us, if not all of us, want to be happy, very few of us really want to be miserable.
Yeah.
I do think the horizon is important here. If you think there's nothing after death, then, of course, this is a very old idea, too.
I mean, sure.
Dostoevsky was very good at it. If God doesn't exist, then why should we have any limit on what we do to increase our pleasure at the moment? And, but the truth of the matter is that God does exist, and loving him involves obeying his teachings
right.
for us.
Right.
That's why he gave them to us. And conveying this to a non-believing world is not easy. There are some wonderful Catholic and other Christian and, frankly, non-Christian organizations that care very much about the virtues. They believe in objective truth. They mm-hmm. articulate them in different ways. And this is, by the way, one of the things that I think the founders understood when they created the First Amendment. So that this is not hopeless.
Right.
There is a certain complacency, not just among Catholics, but I think among most people who really find it a little bit unpleasant or a lot unpleasant to get involved in these political...
Mm-hmm.
Jack, hush. That's my dog. Sorry.
I love it. No, that's great.
In any case, being able to articulate for ourselves what we should do as opposed to what we really want to do.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just a matter of will. It's a matter of using reason and faith to convince others that God is good. true path to happiness.
Right.
So, again, this is so easy to say,
mm-hmm.
but the reason I want to say it in a very clear way is to get people to think about whether they really believe this and understand how this basic truth of our faith is under attack. I suspect many do.
Right.
In so many different ways. But then whether they think they can do anything about it other than just voting for Biden or Trump or being a Republican or Democrat, I don't think that's the solution. I think we need to be Catholic in other ways.
Right. Well, Tom, before we kind of leave kind of that whole kind of political piece here, it does appear that we have kind of shifted when we talk about this religious liberty, religious freedom issue from, you can believe what you want to believe, to you must believe this, almost in the sense that there's coercion now, you know, that people can be fined or locked up or companies can be fined if they don't, you know, put certain things into place or, you know, so how do... Is that something that we should be tackling, and how is best to tackle that?
Well, I think we have no choice. I mean, the first step is to be aware, and there may be some of your listeners who really aren't, and or who out of a sense of modesty or distaste or just not wanting to get involved because it really is a painful thing.
Yes.
I use an example, the recent debate between the former president and the current president, and a large number, I was a little bit surprised at this, of Americans did not watch it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what that is just, I've had enough. I don't want to get involved in this. It's driving me nuts.
Yeah.
Well, okay, but when it comes to the truths of our faith that are being attacked, we have to understand what's going on. So there are laws at the federal level, at the state level, there are local municipalities. So the coercion is coming in, as you suggested. And I'll just give one example at the federal level.
Mm-hmm.
The so-called Equality Act, which has got to be one of the worst-named prospective laws ever invented, although that's just part of politics these days,
yes.
Lies and deception.
Yes.
The Equality Act has been passed by two Democratic-controlled House of Representatives. It's never gotten to the Senate, but President Biden has made it clear it's one of his major domestic priorities. And what it would do is change the Civil Rights Act of 1964 to make protected classes all of those behaviors and people, persons represented in the LGBTQIA plus group of people, and that plus is because it's not finished.
Right.
The gender part of this is ever growing. You become a protected class so that if a Catholic church, for example, if this law were to pass, decided that it could not do same-sex marriages, which I hope most Catholic churches would,
mm-hmm.
they could be sued
mm-hmm.
either by the individuals who believe they're the victims of this or by the attorneys general. And we know from recent history that that would not be an unusual thing for an attorney general to do.
Right.
This would be devastating. I mean, it's not just the Catholic Church. And here's the other part of this, Pat, which is so insidious and revealing that goes to religious freedom. If you are sued under the Civil Rights Act of 1964, if the Equality Act passes, which it will,
mm-hmm.
In one of these days, one way or the other, it'll pass. If you are sued, you may not use religious freedom to defend yourself in court.
Oh my.
You may not say that we are a Catholic church whose teachings are X, or because of Jesus, or an evangelical church, or for that matter, Muslims or Jews or any other group,
yeah.
use religious freedom as a defense is explicitly forbidden by the Equality Act. Now, think about what that means about the valuation of this precious thing we used to call the first freedom.
Yeah.
It is no longer, for those who support this, the first freedom of our country. It is an obstacle to the achievement of their remaking of what it means to be human. And mm-hmm. that is very, very dangerous. And I would ask others to consider the what this means for their lives, for their children, their grandchildren, and all of their progeny.
Yeah.
And I would also just point out school boards. I mean, people, I think, are aware of school boards who are passing, have passed ordinances that require nurses, school nurses, teachers, administrators, if they have a child, a young child who comes to them in school and says, I think I'm in the wrong body, I'm actually a girl in a boy's body, or the reverse, the parents may not be informed. Now,
wow.
I cannot think of much else that is a turning on the head of the consensus that has existed in this terribly disputatious country for almost two centuries. I mean, the idea that obviously there are outliers, but there was a consensus that parents raise their children. That's the best way for families to operate and for the country to operate, not for government to mandate the way these things are done.
Right.
Very dangerous. We need to get on top of this, and we need to begin to chip away at it. We're a minority now.
Yeah.
Catholics have always been a minority in this country, still are numerically, but we have become part of the mainstream, and that has brought with us some costs to us and to our faith.
Yes, that's very true. And I think, you know, we've got about a minute left in this segment, but I one of the things, too, we hear so often is it seems like the movement is away from religious liberty to just freedom of worship. You know, keep it in church. You know,
yes.
But other than that, that's the end of it. And it's just such a misunderstanding of what religion really is. It's like it's so much more than just worship. You know, that seems to be kind of the way they're countering, like, well, you know, nobody's telling you can't go to church, you know, although they did during COVID. But anyway, we are at the break.
Well, no, that was the point I was going to make. Maybe we can come back to this.
We will. Yes.
You know, one would think that freedom of worship, those who wanted to shrink the free exercise of religion, which is something else I'd like to talk about.
Sure.
To worship, you would think they were just doing that to privatize it. But then COVID comes along, and we find that many, particularly blue state authorities, are willing to stop that as well.
Yep. Okay.
Very, very important.
Well, we are at break, and I want to let everybody know that Thomas Farr is our guest today. He wrote an article on free exercise of religion and Catholic responsibility. First director of State Department's Office of International Religious Freedom. He is also the co-founder and president emeritus of Religious Freedom Institute. So come back on the other side of the break. This is a fascinating discussion and so much we need to be aware of. So you're listening to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray.
Do you want to put an end to abortion and the contraceptive mentality for good? Do you want to fight against the homosexual agenda and halt the march towards the legalization of same-sex marriage forever? Do you want to ensure religious freedom for ourselves and for our grandchildren? These things are impossible unless we convert the culture. St. Paul's Street Evangelization is a grassroots initiative that recognizes this need and takes it to the streets. If you're interested in peacefully sharing your Catholic faith in a non-confrontational way with the people in your area, you can help. To learn more about St. Paul's Street Evangelization, visit us at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com. And don't forget to like us on Facebook.
Hello, and welcome back to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray. And today, this has just been a fascinating conversation. We have with us Thomas Farr, just an amazing gentleman. Lots in his background. He was the first director of the State Department Office of International Religious Freedom. He taught at Georgetown in the area of international religious freedoms. He then co-founded and is now president emeritus of the Religious Freedom Institute, and he's writing a book on the American gift of religious freedom. And we're talking about an article that I read in The Catholic Thing, Free Exercise of Religion and Catholic Responsibility. And it's a great article. I would encourage you all to go read that. And welcome back, Thomas.
Thanks, Pat.
It is just wonderful to have you on. This has been a great discussion. So let's kind of go back to kind of the very beginning, if we can, about obviously, and you make mention of this fairly quickly in the article, that the founding fathers, like, this was a unique idea for a country. Can you kind of tell us a little bit about that? Because I don't think we appreciate that.
No, I'm certain we don't. And this is not only true of the, if you can forgive me for putting it this way, the empty-headed people who are at our elite universities these days. It's not only that they don't teach this well to our kids, but unless you're in a really good school, you don't learn anything about it at all. And that is that among the magnificent accomplishment of the founders of this country, I would put at the top or close to the top the religious freedom or the free exercise of religion. And if you know your First Amendment, you know that it guarantees the free exercise of religion for every American citizen and every American religious community in which a citizen belongs. But it also bans the government establishment of religion. So what were they trying to do? Let me just say first, repeat what you said, Pat, and that is what they were doing was unprecedented in the history of mankind.
Yeah.
It had never been done before, and I would say that it has never been replicated by any other democracy, or let alone a non-democracy, since then, which is why, in my view, our country, this is the gift that I'm referring to in the book that I'm writing. It's a gift to us and a gift to the world, which, if it is lost, which it is in danger of being lost by us, will be a terrible tragedy for the United States and for the world, both in terms of our religious citizens and the virtues that this country has built itself on, as well as the rest of the world.
Yeah.
So let me just say a word on what the founders did.
Please.
They wanted free exercise of religion by all Americans, religious groups. They were mainly Protestants, by the way, or formed in some kind of Protestant group. They were certainly not all what we would call evangelical Protestants. James Madison, George Washington, certainly Thomas Jefferson, who was accused of being an atheist with some justification, even though he wasn't.
Right.
I'm happy to talk about that, but it would take a long time to get into all of these. The point is that they were all formed in some kind of religion, and every one of them, including Thomas Jefferson, believed that if we don't have religion in our public lives, we will not have a moral and virtuous citizenry.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I want you to know that you can go to any of these founders and find somewhere in their writings, their speeches, if we don't have a moral and virtuous citizenry, this democratic experiment that we are embarking on at the risk of our lives will fail.
Mm-hmm.
How do we do this? How do we have virtue and morality? Well, that was something that most countries historically believed they could accomplish by imposing religion, by imposing the rules of virtue and morality. These guys said, we're not going to do that because we believe human beings are fallen creatures.
Yep.
Something we talked about earlier.
Yeah.
They will be corruptible by the power to tell other people how to run their lives. So the way to do this is to give every religious individual in every community in this country the right, not the requirement, but the right to engage privately in worship, but also publicly in our public life, in our politics, our civil society, public life, to engage on the basis of their religious beliefs about freedom, equality, justice, virtue, and morality. All of these things that we talk about today, they wanted to make sure that we had them in our public lives. Again, not by giving government the authority to carry them out. That's what the ban on an establishment religion was about, the
right.
so-called Establishment Clause,
mm-hmm.
which has been distorted beyond recognition these days.
Yeah.
They wanted free American citizens within limits. Violence was a big red line. You can't use your religion to be violent against others, nor can you use your religion to require others to be a member of your group.
Mm-hmm.
But within those big red lines, you have the right, and some would argue the duty, to make your arguments in public life. We'll have a big debate about it.
Mm-hmm.
So, by the way, President Clinton, when he signed the Religious Freedom Restoration Act in 1993, which was a very good act,
mm-hmm.
said in his public remarks, they were off the cuff, pretty much what I just said about the founders.
Wow.
And this just shows how dramatically things have changed.
Yeah.
So this is a gift to us and to the world. And I don't think we realize, I'm sure that our kids aren't taught this for the most part. And many of us in what I will call the geezer generation, a proud member of it, who are basically have been running this country for quite a while, do not understand this. Or if we do, we don't want it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
We want to call particularly the people who have anchored the system for two centuries, I'll call them the morally traditional people,
okay.
the people who want to be morally traditional in terms of the virtues, understanding of freedom, which we were talking about a little bit earlier, Pat.
Mm-hmm.
All of these people are now bigots,
yeah.
according to this new ideology. They are haters. They are un-American. That's you and me,
yeah.
and probably some of the listeners to this program.
Mm-hmm.
That is just, first of all, it's a damned lie, if you'll forgive my French.
Mm-hmm.
But it is also a dangerous lie for
yes.
this country, because it is the destruction of religious freedom. So it's very important, I think, that we get our arms around this, because it's too easy to be, oh, gosh, I don't want to be involved in this.
Yeah.
I just don't. I hate it so bad. And I understand that. And I, by the way, I should say I was one of the ones that didn't watch that debate. I taped it.
Yeah.
I taped it and watched it later.
Yeah.
Because I just felt I had to be informed. But
sure.
I don't like to get involved in some of this stuff.
Well, and it's overwhelming.
Religious freedom.
Yeah. It it just gets overwhelming. It's like we're just being pounded all the time, and you just,
yes.
and I think part of it is everything is so overly exaggerated, you know, like this is, you know, and everything is the kind of the end of the world kind of thing. And so it's hard to know what should I be paying attention to, because everything looks like it's on fire. You know,
right.
and so I'm not real sure what I should be paying attention to. So I'm just going to go to the beach. Forget
yeah.
it, you know.
Well, I did that a couple of weeks ago, too.
Yeah.
So I'm with you on that. But the only thing worse than thinking everything is on fire is not realizing what is on fire.
Yeah.
And to me, I mean, speaking for myself and for the Religious Freedom Institute and others who may well agree with me, I know some who do. Many are Catholics and others.
Mm-hmm.
Religious freedom is in big trouble, and
yes.
this is more than just an unfortunate circumstance.
Yeah.
It will change the nature of this country, and
yeah.
one could argue it could. You know, there's a lot of talk about the destruction of democracy, charges on both sides.
Oh, yeah.
and the end of democracy, and so on and so forth. Well, you know, let me just repeat what the founder said 250 years ago. If we don't have a moral and virtuous citizenry, this experiment, this radical experiment in democracy will fail.
Yeah.
And I think it is worthwhile focusing on that and seeing whether you agree with that. And also seeing whether you agree with my point that of all the good people in this country who want to defend religious freedom, I believe the Catholic Church and the Catholics of the Catechism of the Catholic Church are in the best possible position to mount a counteroffensive. We're a minority,
yes.
but we've been minorities before,
mm-hmm.
and I think that's what we need to do.
Well, and I want to get to that, Tom, because one of the things that I think is part of the issue here, And we mentioned Al Crest at the beginning of the show. I always loved his kind of catchphrase, build the church, bless the nation, because I always thought, yes, the church is at the heart of this because it's people. We need to be good people and the nation will be blessed. It will happen. And you mentioned in your article, you know, you talk about kind of these dynamic faith-based organizations or private religious institutions that have done so much good over time, you know, over time, orphanages and immigrants and the aged taking care of them. But one of the things that we have seen over this kind of what I call obviously the modernist or the progressive movement is that government has gotten involved and almost taken the religious institutions' ability to minister in these areas away. Like they, you know, you like Catholic charities with doing adoptions. You know, well, you have to adopt out to same sex couples. Well, we're not going to do that. Well, then I'm sorry. You know, there are places that you know, they want to set up soup kitchens or whatever, and or they want to help in some way, and there's some regulation that's not going to allow them to do it. And I just heard the other day that, and I haven't, unfortunately, I haven't read it. Maybe you have, but that there's some rumblings in the federal government about getting involved in homeschooling. And homeschooling is one of those areas now that is kind of the last vestige for parents that don't want their kids exposed to all this stuff. So, right. So you know, all of these kind of fingers into these religious institutions that have kind of almost ground certain ministries to a halt. And I agree with you. I think, you know, we're certainly in a place kind of to lead this resistance. But my question, let's kind of look at it in two ways. What makes the Catholic Church and the teachings, what makes us unique to be able to kind of mount this resistance? And then I want to talk about how do we do it. But what makes us kind of unique in your eyes that gives us the responsibility to do this?
Right. Well, of course, without wanting to offend any non-Catholics,
sure,
who are listening, I think the answer is the truth. I believe that the Catholic Church is filled with sinners, I first among them. But we have access to the truth of what Jesus meant and when he was incarnated, lived, suffered, died, and resurrected. Is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he taught us what the truth about love and about justice and about courage and about all of the virtues that we should have, the virtues, the gifts of the Holy Spirit and the cardinal virtues, all of them. It's not that Catholics are better at this, but it is that we have in the scriptures, in the magisterium, and in the catechism of the Catholic Church, all of the teachings that we need to understand how to live our lives.
Mm-hmm.
Our wonderful Protestant brethren believe the Bible is the sole authority. As I see it, their problem is one of authority itself, because there are many different interpretations of what the Bible says. And, of course, their response to that is, well, you Catholics, you know, you just believe what the Pope says.
Right.
And I must say that is certainly not the case.
Right.
But it is that we do have a coherent expression of the entire meaning of life. And if we can summon the courage and the wit and God's help to live our lives in this way, we can lead this counter-resistance. Now, so the answer to your question is I think we're best placed for this because we are an institution that has existed longer than any other institution in the history of mankind.
Right.
We are an institution that draws on those classical, some of those pre-Christian classical truths, particularly the ancient Greeks, Aristotle and Plato, about the meaning of virtue that rendered the truth about this. We draw on the wonderful Jewish tradition that preceded us, and we have the truth. And if we can live it, if we can convince others that this is the way to happiness, mm-hmm. then I think we can have a major impact. So that may sound like a, I'm giving those people who consider us bigots and haters more ammunition. I don't think so. I think we're lovers.
Yeah.
We're not haters.
Right.
And we are the ones that have the opportunity, if we'll take it, if we have the wit, if we have the courage to regain this great country, which gives us the opportunity to do just this. And one more thing, and then we can move on to your next point. This is what the founders intended. They were, by the way, many of them were anti-Catholic.
Yeah.
In fact, all of them thought, the Pope was a problem and so on and so forth.
Sure.
But many of them were pretty viciously anti-Catholic, and yet they built a system that they knew would invite the Catholics to be part of it.
Right.
And here we are 250 years later, and we have an opportunity to use the free exercise of religion as they intended it. They couldn't have known about all of this stuff we're talking about, particularly the gender identity stuff.
Right.
They knew about all the rest of it because it was part of human nature. But what they wanted us to do, we can do, and that is use the free exercise of religion, not to coerce, not to trick or punish or manipulate anyone, but to tell the truth about what a human being is, mm-hmm. and thereby win people back over to reality. This isn't some spiritual opinion.
Right.
This is about the way the world really is.
Yeah. Yeah. Very true. And I love one of the lines in your article, and I'm going to read it because I think this was like, it kind of flies in the face, I think, of what the progressive movement in our country tries to put forth. But you say, our primary job is not to save the world or even our nation, but to be faithful to Jesus Christ by being his disciples. And I love that line because I think it keeps first things first, right? It is that idea that when we are faithful to Christ Jesus, the kingdom will be present, but as long as we think we're trying to fix the country, we're going to have problems. So
that's right. I mean, I'm so glad you read that, Pat, because I am not making the argument that Catholics can save the United States of America.
No.
I am making the argument that we have the duty in faithfulness to Jesus Christ to be his disciples. He will decide what happens to the United States. But he asks of us to be his disciples, and I am convinced that means being good citizens of the United States, the only country in the world, in the history of the world, in which its constitution gives us that right.
Mm-hmm.
And so duty and right go together, and I think it's a perfect combination.
Yeah.
But yes, we can't save it. We're not going to save the world. We're not going to save our country. We're just going to be faithful to Jesus. And as I think it says in the piece, if it's the will of God, then it will be given us what we need to do that.
And I teach moral theology. So anytime I see the virtues, cardinal and theological, I get excited in an article. So when you talk about the virtue of hope, that we are people of hope, that we are not people of discouragement. And I think that is something we have to be so focused on, I think, in this day and age, because I hear a lot of hopelessness, a lot of people that just want to give up. You know, our country's too far gone. It's going to, and again, I think it's trying to get people to focus back on what is really important, and that is Christ Jesus. So if we're about that, we just have to trust, place our hope in him, and trust that, like as you say, things, he will work it out according to his providence, not our providence, but his providence. And that's a hard thing for us to do, that's for sure. But I think, go ahead, Tom.
I was just going to say, trusting in him means acting in his name.
Mm.
With love and with the virtues. Trusting does not mean passiveness, allowing Caesar to, take the things of God into his hands. It means obeying him in the world as citizens of this country. I'm convinced that's true, and I think that's an important decision that every Christian, every Catholic, and frankly every citizen needs to make for themselves, whether they're simply going to accuse the morally traditional people of this country of bigotry and hatred and ask them to be silent, or whether they're either going to be refuse to be silent,
yeah,
or to defend the right of people to engage.
Well, one of the things, Tom, that I think you brought, well, you did bring up in the article, and I want to kind of delve in a little bit here, is because I think that is obviously what every Christian grapples with, in the sense that, yes, I trust that and have hope in God. God, it will all work out according to his plan. But we can't, like you said, just kind of sit back and say, okay, God, do it. We have to cooperate in that mission of Jesus Christ in the world. And so you talk about one of the areas is making more persuasive policy arguments. How do we go about that? How are ways that we can do that?
Well, you know, I mean, I'm reminded of my Protestant past. I mentioned I was a convert and raised in the South as a Methodist, and wonderful, wonderful memories of my childhood and my early adulthood. My wife and I were married as Methodists, and I remember the old, I think it was a Methodist story about how the pastor, when he was asked what he did with the collection, he said, well, I go back into the vestibule or wherever, and I take all the money in the collection, and I throw it up, and I say, God, you keep whatever you want, and the rest of it comes down. Well, that's not what we're talking about.
Right.
I mean, we're not talking about trusting in God in the sense that we have to be quiet and remain where we are. Trusting in God means making policy arguments.
Mm-hmm.
Now, my mother used to say, don't talk about politics and religion at the dinner table. Well, that's one of the worst pieces of it. Well, maybe at the family dinner table, but not at the national
table.
Policy level. We've done well on abortion. Just think about it. I know that a lot of people are upset about some of the, and they should be, about some of the referenda and,
mm-hmm,
and things. But think about how that is the one place where primarily Catholics, with a lot of support from our Protestant brethren and others, other good people, have really held the line. And we still, we have a lot of work to do, but we know how to do this.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to change hearts and minds. Politics, is part of it. We need these laws, but we also need politicians who believe that in the human life and the sacredness of life from conception to natural death. That's our job.
Mm-hmm.
That's a political thing as well as a cultural thing. So in practical terms on abortion, if you don't want to get into the argument about how many weeks and whether your state should have 6 weeks or 15 weeks or a ban on abortion or whatever, talk about why this is important. Talk about why every human being, and by the way, that's not just the position of the Catholic Church, it's the
right
position of science, embryology, should have the same legal protections as you or I.
Mm-hmm.
Why should they have no legal protection? This is just a matter of common sense. Of course, it's not common sense to everyone.
Right.
Those who defend the right to life are bigoted and haters like everybody. We need to overcome that with loving persistence. But that extends to policy arguments about same-sex marriage.
Mm-hmm.
Why shouldn't people be allowed to marry as they want? Well, that's not an easy one. It's not an easy solution,
mm-hmm,
because it is now a fundamental right. This is why I say the courts cannot solve this problem.
Right.
They're part of the problem.
Mm-hmm.
How do you argue about this? Well, you talk about the meaning of the human person. This mm-hmm doesn't mean we don't love people with same-sex attractions.
Exactly.
Nor does it mean we insist that they not have any rights or that they cannot live together. But marriage
is different.
Marriage is something that is being destroyed in its meaning for our country. Talk about what that means.
Mm-hmm.
Why is it important for marriage to be one man, one woman? Why is it that the entire history of mankind has seen it that way as a matter of the common good? not just these Catholics or these Christians or whatever.
Right.
It is for the common good. Make those arguments. Those are policy arguments.
Yeah.
Of course, you can go to each one of these things. It's the use of faith and reason, and that is what Catholics are best at their best.
Yes.
John Paul II, Fides et Ratio, faith and reason, said, faith and reason are the two wings by which we fly to the truth. That's what we need to do, but we need to do it not just as a matter of worship, thanking God for these things, but taking that into the public life of our country.
Wow. Yeah, that is so true. And we are like a minute away from ending our show, Tom. Is there anything else you would like to kind of just give us an insight into quickly in this area?
If I might, just a plug for the Religious Freedom Institute, which
sure.
you can find by Googling rfi.org or religiousfreedominstitute.org.
Mm-hmm.
You can see what we do. It's about education. It's about teaching students at all levels, including old students like me, about why this is important. And you will see it's not overtly a Catholic organization, but hopefully, whether you're Catholic or not, you will see what I've been talking about today as Catholicism as the basis for this education. It's not about give us our way. It's
right.
not about give the Catholics what they want. It's about what is the truth about the human person.
Yeah.
And if it is true, it's good for our country. We're losing that. And religious freedom, our founders gave us as a means to correct that problem.
Well, I want everybody to know our guest today is Thomas Farr, first director of the State Department's Office of International Religious Freedom. He taught at Georgetown on these issues. He's also the co-founder and president emeritus of the Religious Freedom Institute that he was talking about, and he's currently writing a book on the American gift of religious freedom. Tom, thanks so much for being with us.
It's been a pleasure, Pat.
And all of you that were listening, thanks so much for listening. And as a piece of Tom's quote here at the end of the book, this week, witness the truth by exercising your religion with faith, hope, and love. You've been listening to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray.
But the Lord said, "Truth."